They don't want to wait.
They quieted down in anticipation, so I might ask.
It's a pleasure to welcome you today to the fourth annual Joseph W. Mountin Lecture. I'd like to thank Kim Van Cleef for doing the sign interpretation for us today. And I'd like to pass on one item of business before we start. We have now collected over $56,000 for the combined federal campaign, so we're two-thirds of the way to our goal. And for those of you who are, like I am, doing this early, I hope you'll take advantage this week of contributing. It's 6 weeks ago, or 6 years ago today, that a cook in a hospital in Somalia developed smallpox, the last naturally occurring case of smallpox in the world. It's ironic and it's also poetic that the last person was not only a victim of smallpox, but in a very real sense, a partner in the struggle against smallpox, because that person got smallpox by trying to help two children with the disease find their way to a ward. Well, today, in the midst of death and destruction in Beirut and other parts of the world, we celebrate the smallpox victory as members of the public health community with some tangible evidence the world can be made better, and remarkably that we can play a role in that improvement. My hope is that CDC will pause every year at this time to recall the end of an era. A special part of our remembrance this year is to celebrate with Don Hopkins the release of his book, Princes and Peasants. Don has been nominated, as many of you know, for this year's Pulitzer Prize, an honor that shows that others have recognized the qualities that are very familiar to us, and I suspect that this is a first in the CDC family. We will have a signing ceremony after the talk today. It's sponsored by Cher. These are the first books that have been released. The official release of the book will be during the first week of November, I believe. Is that right, Don?
29th
of November. 29th of November, so we're a month ahead of the official release. Oh, great. And Don will be available to sign the copies that you buy. We'll also have a reception with coffee being served afterwards in the hallway. We've named this remembrance after Dr. Joseph Mountin, because he was so important in establishing CDC. So we remember both the end of an era and the beginning of an era today. It's such an honor to have Dr. Boisfeuillet Jones with us today. And I specifically call him Dr. Boisfeuillet Jones. He had a slight objection because there were honorary degrees, and I told him that he had earned those degrees as much as any buddy at CDC. In the years we were formed at CDC, Dr. Jones was first as a political science professor, then as dean of administration, then as vice president and administrator of health services. In 1961, he was appointed by President Kennedy as special assistant to Secretary Ribicoff for Health and Medical Affairs. He was the equivalent of the Assistant Secretary for Health now, and in fact, he was very directly CDC's boss at that time. He had a line responsibility for CDC. He also was the direct boss of the Surgeon General, Luther Terry, during those years, and at the time of the Surgeon General's first report on smoking. So he was involved in the Health, Education, Welfare Department at a very interesting time. For the past 20 years, he has been president of various foundations. While he has many awards, many honors, has been a member of numerous commissions, I'd like to suffice it to say that this is a man who is held in just the highest regard in educational service circles, in health circles, in foundation circles. It's an honor to introduce Dr. Boisfeuillet Jones to tell us about her early years. Dr. Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, public-private partnership for the common good is a phrase often heard today. It means different things to different people. Special interest groups, it means bringing public policy into focus with their concerns. To regulated industries, it means relaxing rigid requirements to conform with realities of the business world. To government budget planners, it means transferring costs of public responsibilities to the private sector. To CDC and Emory, it has no special meaning. Public-private partnership merely describes, for these two institutions, a state of mind, a mutuality of interest, an informal understanding, an effective relationship now existing for some 37 years between these institutions. Now, documentation concerning this relationship in the early years is scarce, and not many are around who recall events marking the growth of these two agencies. My remarks will intersperse fact, hearsay, legend, and personal experience with a request that I be given the right to correct the record should this become necessary. Now, I've got something of a manuscript here that goes along in this vein. Dr. Foege has thrown me a little bit of a curve, and he said, why don't you just talk about some of these experiences which we discussed informally from time to time. So I'm afraid what you're facing now is a little bit of formality and a great deal of informality. But if you'll bear with me and understand why, then we'll get through this period without too much trauma, I hope. Now, first, I want to speak of Emory and its planning for the future, beginning back in about 1944. At that time, the president of Emory, Goodrich C. White, asked the planning committee of the School of Medicine to reinvestigate, as he said, the present needs and future requirements for a program of continued progress in the development of the medical school. As could be expected, the committee reaffirmed that Atlanta is an ideal place for a medical center serving the Southeast, that Emory should assume such a leadership role, that research was an integral part of teaching, that the clinical teaching program should continue a relationship at Grady Hospital, that the development of the medical school should be on the Emory campus. And I interpose a comment there that in the 1944 Planning Committee report, the recommendation was that the medical school be developed at Grady Hospital. 2 years later, this decision was rethought very carefully, and in 1946, a supplementary report gave a rather exhaustive rationale for developing the medical school on the Emory campus while continuing a teaching relationship with Grady Hospital. I emphasize that because I'm not so sure, but that the development of the Communicable Disease Center and the possibility or even probability of its location adjacent to the campus spurred thinking along the line of a major medical center here in this area embracing a number of non-Emory institutions that would be affiliated for the mutual advantages of proximity in working on health problems. I go on to say that postgraduate teaching was a part of the school's responsibility and that selected departments must be strengthened. The committee recommended, among other things, specifically as follows. It is of paramount importance that plans be made for the early establishment of a Department of Public Health and Preventive Medicine. Now, this theme has been carried through Emory's development program for the health services since that time with virtually no variation. A major report in 1952 spelled out in considerable detail what would be required as Emory moved on to become a really first-rate medical center. I'm down to a story. Every now and then I'll interject one to satisfy Dr. Foege and hopefully you folks. Mr. Robert W. Woodruff, who has been a major supporter of the medical center at Emory and of the university and of a lot of other things around our community, was on Emory's Board of Trustees first in 1935. In 1938, he became a member of the Executive Committee, on which he served for about 10 years. It was during that period that the problems of housing properly, CDC, began to emerge, and he took a very active interest in this. But after this, he had said, along with two other of his colleagues on the Board of Trustees, that the three of them, dividing the cost equally, would underwrite a deficit for the School of Medicine if the school would move into what had been recommended in the report I cited for development of full-time people in the major departments. This deficit had been incurred. The two other people dropped out fairly soon, left Mr. Woodruff carrying the whole load, which he did. Till 1952, he became concerned that here he was stuck with something he couldn't do anything about, and the university not knowing until about the middle of the year whether he was going to pick up the deficit in whole or in part, or at all. It wasn't very satisfactory to each, so he asked the university to produce a blueprint of its plans for development of the health services, including the schools of medicine, dentistry, nursing, the hospitals, and related health activities. I was dean of administration at the time. And I say this only to show you how I got into this field, quite by accident, really. And I was asked to prepare this plan, which I did in consultation with the respective deans, the major faculty representatives and others in the university who were concerned. A plan was presented and adopted by the Emory trustees, presented to the Emily and Ernest Woodruff Foundation, of which Mr. Robert Woodruff was chairman and was the major vehicle for his philanthropy. They studied by an expert over a period of some months, where the university started immediately on January the 1st, 1953, implementing the plan. I won't go into details at all, but I do note that at the same time that program was undertaken, Dr. Theodore J. Bauer became the chief of the Communicable Disease Center. The plan reiterated the commitment to affiliated independent agencies and listed 8 divisions of the university that would be included and 8 independent institutions, of which the Communicable Disease Center was one. And there was no articles of affiliation, no contract. Some of the institutions were in a contractual relationship, but not CDC. It's always been a matter of just mutual understanding and support. I won't take the time to read the language of the report, but at that time it amounted to the requirement for $4 million of endowment, the income from which would underwrite the committed deficit of the medical school, Division of Basic Health Sciences to serve all of the health divisions and the graduate school, a facility for clinical members of the faculty to practice medicine as a private partnership while teaching in this medical school without cost to the school and with contributions from the partnership to support the medical school and research activities. The plan really, as I say, was studied and then accepted by the Woodruff Foundation, and they provided the $5 million that was required. Meanwhile, they picked up the deficit for 1953 because they were studying the report. They agreed to finance it in December of 53. And that year of 53 was the last time the Woodruff interest or anyone else has had to make a contribution to underwrite deficits of the medical school. The plan's been operating for about 30 years. It has been widely recognized and copied, and we're very pleased about that. Now I'll go back a little. CDC was the malaria control in war areas program. The war, World War II, for those of you who don't remember, was winding down, and the malaria program was not considered to be necessary much longer. Several Emory-related doctors, 3 of them particularly, who had chaired that first planning committee report, Dr. Glenville Giddens, Dr. Finnessy Calhoun, and Dr. James E. Paulin, very prominent names in medical circles in Atlanta and elsewhere during those days. These people are the same ones who made a very strong bid on behalf of the malaria control group to keep an organized group under the Public Health Service in Atlanta to work at the problems of communicable diseases, so that there was a tie from the very beginning with Emory in terms of support for what the Public Health Service wanted to do. Senator Richard B. Russell, then junior senator from Georgia, but very powerful as a member of the Appropriations Committee, became quite interested in the problem of housing CDC. And he advised CDC, consequently those of us at Emory, that in order to get an appropriation through, it would be helpful if a site were already available without cost to the government. Emory bought some acreage where we now are, gave 15 acres of it to the federal government in 1947 for purposes of locating a CDC facility. Emory did not have the money to pay for it. They just bought it anyway. 2 years later, they sold some land down at Grady that was not needed any longer, and the board gave permission for that money, some of that money, to be used to pay off the debt that Emory incurred to provide CDC with a site. Now, Mr. Woodruff was involved. I'd always had the feeling, I can't find it in the record, that he had actually given some money for use at Grady, which turned out not to be needed, and he agreed that this would be a good way to use that money. I still think perhaps he had provided the original land at Grady, which was then sold to Grady. So he was involved. In any event, he was quite interested in the project. I keep tying this theme all through because it makes an interesting tie-in and record. About 1951, CDC, as I read the record, needed plans for a facility here. I think it embraced 7 buildings. These were modified to leave off the 7th building because of a ceiling on what seemed to be available for appropriation. The Korean War had come along and stopped federal construction. The effort by Congress and the administration to control the federal debt at that time also put a damper on federal construction, and it was very difficult to get the money. In fact, I say we didn't get it till 10 years later. Or 8 years later. During this period, there were efforts made to find other ways to finance federal construction, one of which was a purchase program in which a federal building or facility would be built with money by a private contractor, and the government would lease it for a fixed number of years, and at the end of that time, the lease money would have paid for the building, and the title then would be transferred to the government. Personally, I think the program was highly ill-conceived. It just cost the government more over the long period, and better to just go on and spend it when they were developing the facility and not build anything they felt they couldn't pay for anyway. They had a ceiling on the original program of 4% interest that would be paid the private contractor, private financier. And the program just didn't go at all because over a period of 2 or 3 years, inflation had taken hold. Finally, several projects were approved, including CDC, and then the director of the administrator of the General Services Administration, under whom this program was administered, suspended the whole business. Just said, program isn't working, we don't know why, but we're not going to start with any projects. Well, I won't go any further except late 1957, they did go ahead with a few projects of this kind. A bid was accepted for interest at 4.97% to build this facility. I think, Dr. Foege, we all made a mistake not building a lot of things with that kind of interest rate over a 25-year period. In any event, it was horribly frustrating to the chiefs of CDC and their supporters in the Bureau of State Services, the Surgeon General's office, and in the department in Washington, that they couldn't get what was so badly needed for a developing competence, which already was beginning to show the potential of what was available. At one point there in 1956, the project seemed so assured that CDC had a groundbreaking committee, and the record shows that this committee made an appointment with Mr. Boisfeuillet Jones and the Emory officials, the way it reads, to discuss groundbreaking ceremony. It was 1958 when finally there was a construction approval and contract, and the building was completed and dedicated, the first group of six buildings completed and dedicated in September of 1960. I remember well the dedication ceremonies. CDC had a flatbed truck pulled up back of the facility, and it had the officials on the platform. Dr. Arthur Fleming was then Secretary of HEW. Dr. Leroy Burney was Surgeon General. And they came to the dedication, and Emory gave a dinner for them the night before. But somehow they got terribly late, about 9:30 before they arrived at the dinner. It was at a downtown club, and drinks were being served at the time, and they finally decided, we sure better go ahead with the dinner before they get here. We won't be able to have a dinner. It was not really alcohol abuse, but it sounds like it. I would like to speak of the frustrations of Dr. Anderson and Dr. Clarence Smith, who were the directors during that time. It was my privilege to know all of the directors, chiefs and directors of CDC, beginning in 1946. Some I knew extremely well because we commiserated over a period of 10 years to get this facility built. I'll interject just one other story at this point that early May 1964, I had a call from Mrs. Lyndon Johnson. Said she wanted to spend a day in Atlanta. And was there something I could suggest that she might do while she was here? She wanted to come early in the morning and leave late that afternoon, a one-day stop. I said, well, certainly, a lot of things you can do in Atlanta. She was first lady at the time. So I got busy and worked up a schedule for her. The main event was the groundbreaking for the facility in which we are now seated. Now, a groundbreaking had not been scheduled, but I called Dr. Jim Goddard, explained the opportunity, and CDC quickly worked up a first-rate groundbreaking for this facility. I don't know how long after that before they actually got the ground broken, maybe even got authorization, but they got the building, that's for sure. And just incidentally, as citizens of the community, she stopped and unveiled the original model of the Atlanta Memorial Arts Center with families of the people lost in the oily plane crash present. She came out to the dedication here. She had lunch at the president's home at Emory and then spoke at Emory to a full Glenn Memorial Auditorium. She went to a reception at the governor's mansion. The legislature was in session, so there she went back. She had a full day, but CDC was the focal point, thanks to your good offices. And I might say, Jim Goddard was a little bit more flamboyant than some of your other directors. And he had on his white uniform, full and complete. I didn't know at that time the Public Health Service had a white uniform, but he was very proud that it was a service organization. Because of the things that you had done and others had done here at Emory, somehow I was invited to come to Washington in the job that Dr. Foege had mentioned. I had the health activities of the department, including the Public Health Service, Food and Drug Administration, Maternal and Child Health, Vocational Rehabilitation, and a few miscellaneous matters. Dr. Luther Terry had come in at the same time I did, in January of 61, as Surgeon General. They had a lot of interest and experience. But because of your special interest in smoking, which Dr. Foege mentioned, I'll tell you this incident. The Surgeon General's report, first report on smoking, had just become available. A press conference had been arranged for the Surgeon General to release this report. And there was so much press interest that we didn't have room in HEW. We went over to the State Department and borrowed their press room, big auditorium. I rode over Terry. On the way over, I said, Luther, who was a chain smoker himself, you realize that after you release this report, you must stop smoking. He said, yeah, I've been thinking about that. So we get there, and after he had made his summary report, about the second or third question he got was, Dr. Terry, do you smoke? Dr. Terry said, no. And the reporter said, have you ever smoked? Dr. Terry said, yes. The reporter said, well, when did you quit? He said, I've just quit. So, it wasn't all rough. Some bright spots. Now, my time is about gone. I have left the theme a little too much. I would like to read, if you'll bear with me, this particular policy statement out of the 1952 report, which really is the basis of the last operation since that time. Modern medical, this is a policy statement. Modern medical schools properly are sharing leadership in all activities in the field of health in their communities and regions. The communities expect such leadership and want it. Independent community enterprises in the field of health, independent community enterprises in health service fields ask and expect to receive consultation, advice, and active participation in their programs by a medical school and its faculty. Such participation usually is most effective when the independent health facility is located geographically near the medical school. Likewise, certain of these facilities are useful in a medical school's program of teaching and research in the health fields. It is proposed that Emory University actively encourage independent community agencies of the type normally affiliated with a medical school in a medical center development to locate new physical facilities adjacent to the main campus. And then the report lists types of facilities, and I mentioned before that it specifically includes CDC, and it has a note there. negotiations already in process for this construction in the world. In 1967 was sort of a progress report, which said, and incidentally, the group of Emory and affiliate institutions were given the name by Emory with permission of the affiliates, but without any special obligation, the term Woodruff Medical Center of Emory University. In recognition, obviously, of what Mr. Woodruff had done through the years, he resigned from the Emory board in 1948, saying that he thought he could do more good for Emory off the board than on the board. His first support of Emory was to set up the Robert Winship Memorial Clinic in the Emory Hospital in 1937. Since that time, including the value of this land on which we are located now, have amounted to about $225 million from his own money and money that he has influenced for development of the medical center and the university here. Certainly, I don't know what he would have done if he'd stayed on the board, but he couldn't have done much more off the board, and it's been quite a help, and that's why his name. Now, one reason he became so interested in health medical school, aside from concern about cancer, was malaria at his Itchaway plantation in Baker County in southwest Georgia, which he acquired in about 1927. Along about 1928, a black man who had been a longtime resident of the area drove by in a wagon, stopped where Mr. Woodruff and his farm manager were standing, said he just wanted to come by and shake the hands of the boss. And while he was standing there, he began shaking at a sort of a egg, and he went on after he got over his attack, and Mr. Woodruff said, "What in the world's the matter with that fella?" His manager said, "He has malaria." Turned out about 60% of people in the whole county had malaria. Mr. Woodruff ordered a barrel full of quinine tablets from Atlanta, sent down there. He employed a physician and two public health nurses, supported them through the county health department. They ferreted out, wherever they could, people who were victims of malaria. And in cooperation with CDC, through the Emory Medical School, and with the Georgia Department of Health, and the Coastal Geodetic Survey, launched a very effective program of study leading to the virtual elimination of malaria by knowing the habits of the vector, the Anopheles mosquito. And there's a bronze plaque on the site of the first of the laboratory buildings provided by Mr. Woodruff on his plantation. I had another after. They've been operating about 19 or 20 years there and about concluded what they wanted to do. Mr. Woodruff thought that all these people down there were not necessarily helping raise his quail like he wanted to, and they had completed their work very satisfactorily, and I got word that he thought maybe it might be time they might want to move. And I talked to Dr. Simmons of CDC very timidly about it. He said, "We have finished our program there, and I want to move some of these facilities to our laboratory in Savannah, and I'm just delighted." So it worked out very nicely. The move was made very rapidly, and I thank Dr. Mel Goodwin, who spent a good bit of time there, is now writing the history of the Emory University Field Station at Itchaway. And I stopped just again just a minute to say that with Mr. Woodruff's compliments, I would like to present to Dr. Foege a privately published biography of Mr. Woodruff and a story of Itchaway Plantation, where your malaria control work was so effective. I'll come back in just a minute. Dr. Dr. Foege assures me they'll be in the library available to anybody who has some interest. Now, you may recall the occasion in April of 1970 when Atlanta's Mayor Ivan Allen Jr., an avid hunter, was bitten by tsetse flies on an African safari in the Okavango swamp of Botswana. He contracted African trypanosomiasis, sleeping sickness, and was carried out of the swamp in 2 days to the village morgue, where a small plane picked him up for treatment in Johannesburg's fever hospital. The doctor in charge said that the treatment administered had been prescribed by CDC in Atlanta. Because he had developed the disease and was brought in so quickly after exposure, the health minister and medical entourage came by to study the case. "I salute you, Mayor Allen," he said. And it seems that the health minister had been a visitor to CDC, probably a trainee CDC, some years before, and had called on Mayor Allen as a foreign visitor courtesy. CDC, this was back in 1970, CDC then and now and continuously has made the world smaller and healthier. I've tried to give you an impression of cooperative effort in the remarkable development of two important health institutions side by side in Atlanta, the public CDC and the private Emory. A true public-private partnership for the common good. When Dr. Joseph W. Mountin, or were he here today at this fourth annual lecture in his honor, surely he would rejoice with us in the CDC-Emory relationship and in recognizing what is also the sixth anniversary of worldwide smallpox eradication, in which CDC played a leading role. I got another story. Incidentally, I happened to be at the World Health Assembly in 1962 and attended the groundbreaking for the World Health Organization Center, as well as CDC Center here in 1960, 2 years before. And I think what you do with the World Health Organization has added to the world's health, as I indicated. Dr. Mountin's idea as head of the Public Health Service, Bureau of State Services, to create separate centers to deal with major health subjects led to play an essential part in redesignated the agency malaria control in war areas as the Communicable Disease Center in 1946. This launched a well-acclaimed competence in the promotion of disease control and related activities here and abroad. We salute him and all of his colleagues of then and now. And I thank you for the personal pleasure and privilege of joining you on this occasion. Thank you.